All right, well, thank you all for coming tonight. Really, really appreciate it. I know it's hard to get off from work and study schedules in the middle of the week. I am going to be introducing Dr. Mark Lawrence. He is the principal investigator, the PI, for the Fish Innovation Lab, or the Innovation Lab for Fish. We are one of over 20 labs across the universities in the United States, and we partner with international partners across the world to help address food security, poverty, malnutrition, some of the other big issues. And Dr. Lawrence is our PI for the Fish Innovation Lab, as I said, and this is also hosted by the Social Science Research Center, where I'm located, and also by the Global Center for Aquatic Health and Food Security. It's just changed its name, so I had to look, had to have my little group notes here to make sure I got it right. But I'm really glad because the part of that name that's new is the health part. So it's the Global Center for Aquatic Health and Food Security. And this is actually hosted at Mississippi State University. The Fish Innovation Lab is supported by the United States Agency for International Development, that's USAID. And we are really delighted to be a part of this and delighted to have Mark at the helm and Laura as one of our major players in the project.
Thank you, Kevin. Well, thank you all so much for coming. It's a great pleasure to have you. And it's indeed my great honor to introduce Dr. Iannotti to you tonight. Dr. Iannotti received her doctorate from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health and a Master of Arts in Foreign Affairs from the University of Virginia. Prior to pursuing her PhD, she worked for over 10 years with UN agencies and non-governmental organizations on nutrition and food security programming and policy. She has expertise in maternal and young child nutrition and nutrient deficiencies related to poverty and infectious diseases. She applies epidemiological methods to investigate interventions aimed at reducing stunted growth and development. She leads projects in Haiti, Ecuador, and East Africa, where she collaborates with local partners to test innovative transdisciplinary approaches to using animal source foods and small livestock and fisheries development. So, but importantly to us tonight, Dr. Iannotti serves as the nutrition cross-cutting theme specialist for the Fish Innovation Lab. And she also leads a project under the Fish Innovation Lab related to nutrition using fish in Kenya. And on a personal note, it was actually Dr. Iannotti that got, that was sort of the final decision for me personally in making the final decision to lead the Fish Innovation Lab. I was looking into it and thinking about it, but I attended an ABMA workshop in February of 2017. And it was an ABMA workshop on the role of animal health in food security globally. And I heard Dr. Iannotti speak at that workshop, and it was that talk that kind of clinched it for me and made me decide, you know, veterinarians have an important role and we can really make a difference. And so I'm sitting up here, I'm a veterinary microbiologist. Dr. Allen is here, Dr. Ragsdale is here, Dr. Iannotti, Dr. Hansen, we're all part of the Fish Innovation Lab. And it's a very diverse team. And working together, we're all working as a team to solve food security and nutrition issues. And so, no matter what your discipline is, the lesson here is we can all work together to solve important issues like food security and nutrition. And with that, I will turn it over to Dr. Iannotti. Thank you.
So thank you, Kathleen. Thank you very much, Mark, for the generous introductions and for giving me such a warm welcome to Mississippi State University. I've been imagining it and seeing it in two dimensions. So it's such a pleasure to finally be here. And then thank you to all of you. I know what it's like at 6 p.m. To come over and listen to a lecture. So I'm really grateful that you showed up for this, and hopefully I can keep you involved and engaged in this. And I'm gonna try to move through the slides quickly so we can get to the Q&A, which I think tends to be the more interesting part of the talk. So I direct the E3 Nutrition Lab, and I tell you this to give you a little bit of context. I focus on young child nutrition, maternal and young child nutrition, and we develop interventions that uphold these three E's as in principle. And the three E's are environmentally sustainable, evolutionarily appropriate, and I'm going to talk about that just a little bit, and then equitably accessed. So we target the most vulnerable populations who, as you will hear about, do not have access to high quality foods. And that's what leads to this problem of hidden hunger. As Mark said, we do research in three countries primarily, in Ecuador, Haiti, and Kenya. And then what we try to do is we take the lessons from the country level and we bring them up to the policy level. And this is part of what we're doing right now with the Fish Innovation Lab is trying to make impacts at the global level with the lessons learned from the country. So working with FAO, WHO, ILRI, and UN Nutrition right now. Since you bothered to show up this evening at 6 o'clock, I'm just gonna keep it really easy and I'm gonna tell you what I'm gonna tell you. Very, very simply summarized. So I'm going to tell you about the global nutrition problem, in particular, this problem of hidden hunger and stunted growth and development that has to do with the lack of access to high quality foods. I'm going to tell you briefly about some dietary patterns in hominid evolution that really suggest that fish was an important part of our evolution. Then I'm going to talk about the nutritional composition of fish and the epidemiological evidence that says fish can be really good for our health. And that's from a public health point of view. Somebody mentioned public health. And if anybody wants to study public health, you can come to our school. We would love that. And then finally, I'm going to finish with the Samaki Salama Kenya research project and a little bit about why the Fish Innovation Lab and all of our theory of change and pathways to impact, and what Mark just mentioned, that transdisciplinary approach has to be the approach that we take in solving these very complicated problems. Okay, so who's affected by malnutrition around the world? We have this, this problem of chronic malnutrition, which manifests as stunted growth, meaning that children are not growing to their full growth potential genetically. But then you have 250 million children who are stunted developmentally, and that's in terms of their brain development, motor development, social emotional, and so forth. Wasting is a form of acute malnutrition, which affects children and adults, actually, usually in humanitarian crises or natural disasters, or an infectious disease. And then on the other end of the spectrum, we have this increasing problem of overweight and obesity. And you'll see in a minute how that overlaps. In the center of the slide is the problem of hidden hunger. And that can affect populations in Starkville, in St. Louis, in Kenya, in Haiti. It has to do with just not consuming the foods that we need to support our metabolism. So a third of children around the world have vitamin A deficiency, or deficient in vitamin A. 18% of children, 19% of women are anemic. And then almost one in five people globally, like of all ages, are not getting enough zinc. And why is zinc important? Because fish is highly concentrated in zinc. And again, we're just not getting the foods we need. 28% are iodine deficient. This to me is one of the saddest statistics, is iodine deficiency, because it's so easy to fix. So don't raise your hand, but think to yourself, how many people buy that pink Himalayan salt? Don't raise your hand, I don't wanna know. It's not a good idea because it's not iodized. And in today's society, because we're no longer living close to the water, because we're no longer living close to iodine-rich foods, we need iodine in our salt. So don't buy the pink Himalayan salt. It's just not a good idea. Okay, so to summarize, and one more thing, COVID has really compounded and added to food insecurity around the world. So we have 80 to 132 million more people who are now food insecure. If we add up all of these problems, malnutrition is the underlying cause in 45% of all deaths to children under five. this was a game changer for us when we were able to do these calculations and show that. And it's a very convincing figure when we go to policymakers. So the UN Decade of Action on Nutrition set some milestones. We've made progress, but we still have a long way to go, and we're pretty close to 2025. And the distance remains primarily for anemia, for exclusive breastfeeding, stunting, and some other milestones. In my view, fish is one of the solutions that we need to work toward getting access to fish that can meet many of these milestones. Usually, I put a map, a global map up of stunted growth. And it actually looks pretty similar to this, but I decided to use my zinc availability and zinc supply in part because of its relevance to fish nutrition. And what you can see here is that there's inequities in terms of the availability of foods that are rich in zinc. If you don't have zinc, then you end up with the stunted growth and development. And then this statistic points to that inequity too. In high-income countries, you have 26 kilograms per capita per year on consumption of fish. Really, that's FAO's estimate of food supply. And then in middle-income countries, 18.8, but then in food deficit countries, it's down to 7.6. So these are dramatic differences in terms of access to fish, and then subsequently the access to zinc. This I show you because it explains in part why the research I've done focuses on young children. So in the global community, we say the first 1,000 days of life are very important for nutrition, because any damage done during that 1,000-day period is essentially irreparable. So if a child is malnourished in that period of time, then they never recover the growth that is lost in that time period. And we really hone in on the 6 to 24-month period, because what happens is, as a child is weaned from the breast, so from exclusive breastfeeding 6 months, they start to consume other foods. They become malnourished. They're also more mobile. They're moving around, and they get exposure to infectious disease, and you have this sharp drop in linear growth and height. And again, you can see it plateaus. You never recover. But I then said, but don't forget about the school kids. Don't forget about the next 3,000 days because of the brain development. We may not see it manifest as growth. It's ongoing inside the brain. So actually, a lot of our research is also now in the school-age child. And you know, the elderly is another age group where I think we need to spend more time, especially with shifting demographics and with the importance of fish and also animal source foods for the elderly. So no life course is immune from malnutrition. Okay, hidden hunger in particular can affect brain development. So it's these brain-selective nutrients. Like I said, iodine is very important in the brain. If you have severe iodine deficiency, does anybody know what that manifests as? Yeah, so it manifests as goiter, and even more severe, it manifests as cretinism. But if you have subclinical iodine deficiency, if you're eating that darn pink Himalayan salt, you might have these sort of subclinical subtle effects in child development, brain development. And you want to pay attention to those. Iron for white matter, myelinization, neurotransmitter, zinc for neurotransmission, again, and all of these other nutrients. Now, if you wait a few minutes, I'm going to show you that these are also the nutrients that are bioavailable in fish. And that's why we often link, you'll see the epidemiological evidence links fish to neurodevelopment, in part because of these nutrients. Okay, so I'm just gonna breeze through these slides, but I wanna present them because I think it partly explains why I spend time on the foods that I do. I think it gives an explanation and a rationale for why there's dietary patterns that we should follow and that we have moved away from in the only recent past. So that's why I'm bothering to spend a few minutes on this evolutionary nutrition idea. So you may think I'm talking about the paleo diet, but I'm not. The paleo diet is sort of built on this, but it's There's actually scientific empirical evidence that upholds this other approach to nutrition. So Eden and Connor introduced the discordance theory, which basically, this was in the New England Journal of Medicine, said that the human genome evolved to adapt to conditions that no longer exist. And the mismatch, the disconnect, is leading to chronic diseases. So we have posited that, beyond chronic diseases, there are all these other conditions that could also be resulting from that mismatch, from the dietary pattern we have today that doesn't look like our evolutionary diet. And then the shore-based paradigm I put up there because it's relevant for fish. So essentially, we evolved around water. And you'll see in a minute, our migratory patterns too were around waterways. And that logically would assume that we were consuming aquatic foods. Simple figure, simple bar graph, just to show proportionality. So Homo erectus is the hominid that looks very similar to hominid, the Homo sapiens today. And that's the one that many anthropologists, thank you, anthropologists in the room, will say where we really turned the corner towards the evolution of towards Homo sapiens. And you can see Homo erectus and all the other hominids were consuming this gatherer-hunter fisher diet for 99.5% of time. Homo sapiens only 9%, agriculture, the advent of agriculture, just a tiny fraction, only 10,000 years ago, 0.53. And then even like lesser in time was 0.01% ultra-processed foods and industrialization. So in the proportion of our evolutionary past, we were consuming something very different than what we are today. Little side note here. So when I started working on this idea of evolutionary nutrition, and I would give presentations, I don't think I did it in AMU. That was pre my evolutionary nutrition work, but I would Google image search for humans in evolution, and all I would get would be men. You could try it right now. You'll see. There's only men in the images, coming from our primate ancestors. Women have evolved too. So I commissioned my sister to draw a picture, and hopefully that's now online somewhere so people can use that. The females evolving too. Anyway, so I digress a little bit, but the Homo erectus, like I said, 2 million years ago, almost 2 million years ago. And now there's these important anatomical differences that people have related to diet changes and the introduction of animal source foods into the diet. Brain size, 3 times the encephalization quotient. We were tall, they were taller, larger body mass, longer legs because we started walking bipedalism, smaller teeth, and smaller colon but larger intestine. Then comes agriculture. And I'm at Mississippi State University, and there's probably a lot of people doing agriculture science. So this is no way implicating agriculture, but this is a reality that we see in the empirical evidence that there were these changes again as we went to a more sedentary plant-based diet. We saw these changes. We lost life expectancy, so from 40 years down to 20 years. We lost height, got shorter. Infection in part because we were living closer together. We were no longer moving around in these gatherer, hunter, fisher groups. But then what people don't realize is we also lost cranial capacity and brain size. What that is attributable to, anthropologists debate that, but many do say that the change in the dietary explains that. Okay, so here's some of our migratory pathways out of East Africa. And you can see many of them are along waterways. I like this only because it shows that we did live and move along water. This was one of my pandemic projects, and it was not an easy one. We decided, not only did we not see women in the images of Google images, we also didn't see children in the literature. So anthropologists will say the same thing. I'm not an anthropologist, public health, nutrition. But they agree with me that people have not really studied what was the child diet in evolution. So we decided to embark on this systematic review. We used literature from multiple disciplines, isotope studies, ethnographies, literature I really never explored before and had to learn how to interpret. But basically what we found is that animal source foods, terrestrial and aquatic, had a lot higher mention frequency in that gatherer hunter fisher diet compared to the early agriculture diet, but also compared to all the other plant food categories. The dietary patterns most common were mammals, followed by thin fish, insects, and reptiles. And then we had fruits, roots, and tubers. So basically, we're just trying to get a little insight into what were those patterns and how can we maybe replicate those today to improve human health and nutrition. And then we saw some evidence that environment was important and the children would forage themselves if it was a safe environment for terrestrial foods, or for example, in mangroves or in like water where there's a fringy reef and the water was calm. Again, pointing to and suggesting that there was foraging, gleaning for these aquatic foods. Okay, so what is the fish potential? When you're in public health nutrition, a tactic we could use to sort of make that argument would be two layers of evidence. What's the nutritional composition of fish? And then the second layer of evidence is what's the epidemiological, strongest epidemiological evidence we can find? And that tends to be the systematic reviews and meta-analyses, randomized controlled trials, where you can show cause and effect for human health in the life course phase. So fish, like other animal source foods, provide these nutrients in a compound, in a matrix that allows our bodies to absorb it efficiently. So vitamin A is a good example. In plant-based foods, it comes delivered as carotenoids, beta carotene, for example, and you need 12 to 24 times the amount that you do for one retinol equivalent you find in animal source foods. Same is true for iron, zinc, choline we know less about. Basically, we metabolize it faster. If you're a young child and you have a tiny stomach, your gastric capacity is very small and you need efficient food mechanism to absorb those nutrients in very efficient way. If you give a child, like many of the populations where we're working with the Fish Innovation Lab, maize or cassava, that's bulky in the stomach and the child cannot consume the nutrients that they need. Does that make sense? Okay. But I always like to say, okay, when I'm teaching about nutrition, don't just think about the nutrients. Don't just think about iodine. You have to think about it in the context of a food matrix. Not even only that, in the diet matrix, and then in the food system. And there's a reason for that, because these compounds interact with one another, and that's going to influence, again, your metabolism, your absorption, and your metabolism. So in the case of fish, this was an image. Do you recognize that image? Do you recognize it? No. We're actually now using it in Kenya for our social marketing, but it came from the UN nutrition report that was done on fish. And it's a really, I think it's a really nice image that shows those nutrients that, again, are bioavailable in fish. A, calcium, zinc, iodine, iron, B12. B12 is only found if there are any vegans in the room, you would know that this, you have to take vitamin B12 supplements, because it only comes from animal sources. Maybe seaweed a little bit, not enough. And then in that constellation of the matrix, you have some of these sort of dark matter or bioactive compounds that we're learning more about. And again, only found in these foods. You can't get them in plant-based foods. And taurine is an example from fish that's kind of an interesting compound that's acting as an antioxidant, plays a number of roles in our muscle health. Anyway, I won't go into those, but this is important to consider beyond just the traditional nutrients. Then you have what's called anti-nutrients. And anti-nutrients, I guess that's what we call in public health, those interfere with absorption. So phytates, tannins, oxalates, they chelate with the zinc, for example, and then pull it out before you can absorb it. So if you're eating lots of maize, which is what we have going on in Kenya right now, you're not getting the zinc. Now, if you eat fish or other animal source foods, you're more likely to absorb. It helps in that absorption process. Okay, this was a paper we just published, and basically what it shows is that all of these aquatic animal foods, over this 3-decade period, they were providing large proportions of important nutrients. One of those nutrients, the most important one, is the long-chain fatty acid, docosahexaenoic acid, and that one we need for brain development. It's not an essential fatty acid, meaning we don't have to get it from our environment. However, if our other fatty acids are out of balance, then we can't make enough of this for brain development. So it's really good if you can give it to a child in the form of fish, and then they have it readily available. Okay, there's no way I have time to cover all the epidemiological evidence that supports fish in human health. So I'm just going to give you a couple examples to point to what qualifies as strong evidence. How do we discern that? And then what is it pointing to in terms of fish? Well, what we see with these systematic reviews and meta-analysis, some recent ones, we see that it's protective against cardiovascular disease. So it reduces the risk of cardiovascular disease events and mortality. And then I pulled an example from pregnant women and children, which shows, again, this important effect on neurodevelopment. Now, these are rigorous reviews. They look for the highest quality evidence. They look for synergy and the convergence of evidence. And they found that, in fact, moderate and consistent evidence shows 4 to 12 ounces of beneficial effects on children. Now, this is some of the literature that resulted in the United States issuing their food-based dietary guidelines, the recommendation to consume fish. But they also found importantly that on the reverse side for harm, there wasn't adverse effects from mercury exposure. And that's good because people in pregnancy for a long time thought, well, can't eat fish because of mercury contamination. But now that has been in the evidence base, we know that the trade-off, the losses in neurodevelopment for your offspring are far greater than the exposure to mercury from big fish. Okay, last slide in this section is just to say that we're not taking advantage of fish. There's so much potential with fish. So only about 17% of the world's population get their animal protein from fish. That's a little bit old. I don't know if the new state of the world fisheries has been updated. I looked and I couldn't find it. Nonetheless, it can't have changed much from 17%. And then I also want to just, before I talk about the research, I want to point to a vulnerable population with some degree of iron need. And that is small and medium-scale food producers. So they produce somewhere between 50 and 70% of nutrients, which is pretty incredible. But they don't, quite often don't get the extension support, they don't get microenterprise, they don't get finance, they don't get, many times they're women, right? And they're not getting that support. And then most sort of ironically, they're also some of the most malnourished populations. These are some of the fishers that we're targeting right in the Fish Innovation Lab, is small and medium scale producers for this very reason. So this is thanks to Laura Z for helping me with the proper slide. Unfortunately, I couldn't get the logo to work in the subsequent slides. Samaki Salama is the name of our fish research in Kenya. I'll tell you a little bit about that. I wanted to put up this theory of change from the Fish Innovation Lab to again emphasize how important it is that we're taking this integrated approach. So as Mark was saying, we're not one discipline, we're many disciplines. And we're thinking about this problem from the production side, from the risk mitigation side, and from the human health outcome point of view. And then taking, we were talking about this earlier, the cross-cutting themes. We feel valued in the Fish Innovation Lab that we're actually taken seriously. And people are paying attention to that in the respective projects. That this, and maybe that's just because it's a requirement of USAID, who knows, but nonetheless, it's I think, making a difference. So in Kenya, we did, funded by the Fish Innovation Lab, we did some formative research called Secure Fish. And in fact, we showed that fishing households were more malnourished than non-fishing households. So those living along the coast were very poor. They were experiencing acute diarrhea. We saw high prevalence of acute diarrhea. Still haven't figured that mystery out, but we're working on it. Also along the coast, we found with this research that they were giving their children stew, but upon closer examination, that stew was basically just water. So the fish was boiled in the water, maybe bones were boiled in the water, and they weren't getting the flesh of the fish. So these are some of the things that we're working on. And then like most poor households, they know they can get a lot more calories in the house if they sell a few fish. And we recognize that that's a serious limitation in these households. And because of that, we're working to increase production so that there's more fish and they can keep some in the household for the vulnerable. So the design of Samaki Salama, it's a cluster randomized controlled trial. And a little bit of a public health nerd, when you have many of my trials are just individual randomized controlled trial. And that's a very easy design and people take you seriously and there's cause and effect. But with a cluster design, it's a little more challenging intellectually to get comparable groups. So what we did is we matched the village. It took a lot of time to match villages on confounding characteristics. And if you come and study public health, you know what all this means and get really good at it. But basically, you want to be able to say that the control group looks like the intervention group so that when there's a difference or there's no difference, that there might have been this cause effect happening from the intervention. We have this beautiful luxury of a 12-month bundled intervention. I've never, my other intervention studies are usually more like 6 months, but this one is 12 months. It combines social marketing campaign with a sustainable fisheries intervention to increase production, but also to protect the reef. And this is modified traps that allow for the juvenile fish to escape. We're promoting fish that are gonna be more sustainable, the top efficient. So the villages that are in the social marketing plus trap group are on the top. And then we have the green, Kurutu, which is where there's just social marketing. And then we have two control communities. And we'll be comparing nutrition outcomes, we'll be comparing livelihood outcomes, a whole range of different outcomes. The flow diagram, you see team fish, as we call them. They're measuring the fish for volume, for length, keeping track of the catch volume. And then over on your right, you see some of the nutrition team eat, as they're called. And they are doing anthropometry, so weight and height, and measuring diet. There's a picture of a trap. Of our great team members. We have fabulous partners and an amazing team in the field. We're collecting the data and doing the intervention. We're collaborating with two Kenyan universities, Pwani University and Egerton, is there well-known universities in Kenya, Egerton in particular, in agriculture, and with some terrific partners. Oh, sorry, my visual identifier. Get in trouble. There's nobody from USAID in here, right? So we have, this is the visual identifier that we carefully constructed with lots of testing and vetting, and that you see that all over the t-shirts and the home visit forms. And we've been very lucky to have a project called Advancing Nutrition with social behavior change experts. I am not that, but they have been helping us to design the social marketing. We're targeting not just moms, but also the fishers, the fathers, and the DMU leaders. And so we're, you know, we're giving the fishers life checks, which I love. It's sort of a public health intervention. It's like unintended safety benefit. But the life check, it's has the visual identifier on it, t-shirts, home visits, cooking demonstrations, a whole range of activities. Lisa developed the Star Foods game, which is kind of cool, where you give the stars for the higher quality foods. You can see the fish on the right of the 3 stars, the high stars. You can see a cooking demonstration there on the right. Now we like to say we want long fish and long children. Long fish because we want them to be adult, mature, and we want tall children. So that's our model. Okay. So to conclude, just a few sort of thoughts on policy. I think, so back in the, some time ago, also a pandemic project, we were working with the E3 Nutrition Lab, was working with the UN Nutrition, which is the umbrella entity at the UN level for other nutrition, all the nutrition players, and WHO and FAO, World Food Program. And UN Nutrition commissioned these two papers, in part because they're sort of on the attack right now with the environment and climate change and the contribution of large-scale livestock production to climate change. And basically, it was a systematic review to look at, again, nutritional composition as well as the epidemiological evidence. And we produced these two papers. And it's part of this effort to translate findings into policy. Basic messages, nutrition inequities prevail around the world. Animal source foods, aquatic and terrestrial, provide critical nutrients. We really need to think about the life course. We can't just say categorically, red meat causes heart disease. Well, maybe that's true in a population that's overweight and diabetic, but that may not be true. And it's certainly not true, for example, with the elderly, where that can prevent certain or not true for young children really need, or pregnant women need for anemia. So it's really important to think about it in the life course frame. And then we need to rebalance entire food systems to think about that, the importance of sustainability and nutrition equity. The UN also had Food Systems Summit in the fall, as well as the Climate Summit. So this whole idea of sustainable healthy diets is what we're working toward. And then we've added this word equitable to think about just food access. Okay, to summarize, hidden hunger affects many populations around the world from Starkville to coastal highlands. The prevalent nutrient deficiencies are those that are concentrated in bioavailable in fish and other aquatic foods. Yet great disparities exist globally in accessing these foods and high quality diets. Integrated approach, like the Fish Foundation Lab, to improve production, increase livelihoods, and ensure vulnerable populations are reached. Policy solutions should ensure nutrition equity and food systems towards sustainable healthy diets. And Feed the Future USAID Food Innovation Lab is one great example of a global initiative that's making these important. Chance to all kinds of important people on these teams. Thank you so much. Unless you can see my our t-shirts.
Thank you so much, Melinda. It's really great. I wanted to know if anybody has any questions from the water. I've got a couple of questions. I'd love to have that people first. So, anyone want to speak up? Yes.
Thanks for the talk. I was curious about the environmental side of what else in these types of interventions to happen? Is that you mentioned preventing events? What other kind of sustainability measures?
I mean, waste to post-harvest loss is one of the biggest kind of contributors. I think that's one of the things that. There's been some interesting papers that I've been following that are linking diet diversity and biodiversity. And that there's a paper that was done by that looked at the range of aquatic foods and how, you know, if we can just promote, this is true categorically, if we can promote a diverse array of foods, it's better for us and it's better. So that's another solution that we're sort of working towards, just to make that point. But I think it's also thinking about the scale of production and types of foods that we promote. But yeah, it's in public health nutrition, it's the most important question right now.
To obtain the levels of nutrients that you cited in fish, is it important to eat multiple organ systems in the fish or just fish flesh?
I'm so glad you asked that. Like I forgot to say that. We had this whole thing in Kenya where we're going around from community and talking about how the fish brain is always safe for the dog. Because it's the most nutritious. And there are different parts of the fish that are really important in different ways. So all kinds of different aquatic animals are important in different ways, and then parts of the fish are also. So another example is the eyes, the glossing in them, but the brain. I know a little bit more, I would say, about terrestrial animal differences and less about fish, but it's one of the things I think we should be paying attention to. Yes, close. Yeah. Yes. Yes. I'm glad you asked that because that means I'm going to change that just slightly and make sure I caveat.
Can everybody hear that in the back? You know, she has a very soft voice, so can everybody hear? Everybody knows
they can't hear over here.
Okay, could you kind of like?
Yeah. So she's asking because the literature, and she's absolutely correct. In fact, the World Food Prize winner this year, her research focuses on small fish. So she was asking the question about my image of long fish, long children. And to explain that, it's within that particular fish that we're aiming for. That's the toppy fish, the rabbit fish that we're trying to get long. And that just has to do with being juvenile versus being mature. But your point is really important, which is that in many populations, the small fish is what is reserved at home. And this is one of those instances where there's a happy injustice around that, meaning that the small fish are actually very nutritious because they're concentrated. Sometimes the bones get eaten at the same time because they don't have the environmental exposures and contamination, like you said. So it is something that we've been promoting as well as the, but that's not what I meant at all. It's only eat big fish now. Yeah. Eat mature fish is what I mean. It's generally
okay. She answered it all.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. I need my moving control just around the but basically they are, they eat at the lower end of the trip, right? So they're herbivores. Who else is they're more plentiful. So the parrotfish is another fish they're fishing that, and they harm the coral reef and the top of fish do want it. They have a short lifespan, that's another reason. So they're regenerating more. But there are several reasons. My own ecologist can.
Just a simple question. What does Samaki Salami mean?
It's actually reminiscent of our quick start, which means secure fish.
Secure fish. Just a follow-up on that. You mentioned that people will trade, sell fish to get things that fill them up. And so the solution you had, so the long-term solution you invested is greater production. It's more efficient harvest or post-harvest reducing loss. What do you see as sort of the near-term solution for something like that? And maybe the long, how do you get those longer-term solutions?
I mean, that's exactly the right question, which is what do we do in the short term just to hold people over until we address these other intractable systemic problems of poverty, right? And low fish production. In my view, you can't do one without the other. So simultaneous with doing a short-term solution, we need to be working on these long-term solutions so that we address the fundamental problem here, which is poverty. I don't know. I used to work on, these fortified peanut butter paste. You guys heard of these, like the plumpy nuts, and there are these peanut butter paste that are meant for that short-term solution where, okay, well, we can't fix poverty in the short term, but we can give the child this, and that particular child's going to grow. I've moved away from that because it's just not sustainable. People can't afford them. They end up throwing the trash, and they also don't provide the nutrients in the same way that you have this whole food matrix. So I've moved all of my research towards that, and we're trying to work on foods that are not so expensive, like eggs and milk and fish. I think there are other short-term solutions like food vouchers and conditional cash transfers, and those should be part of it. You're right, simultaneous, long-term, short-term should be happening.
So is that connected? Because I really agree that increasing fish consumption is a really good solution for food consumption as well, and the fish or the flavors. But the more there is one, I love it, the better. So.
Well, it goes back to the same approach, which is that transdisciplinary approach. And we need to, we're also working on demographics, on reproductive health. I couldn't agree more. Not my area of expertise, but I think it's important to pay attention to that and to look at our shifting demographics, population growth, as well as those, again, the life course differences too. Yeah, it's an important point. And I also think, that's why I keep using the word equity, I keep using the word rebalance. You clearly have overconsumption going on in some populations and underconsumption in other populations. And that's part of the solution too, is rebalancing.
Thanks, Victoria. Happy baby wow. Fish stew in water. That's such a good thing. So I was wondering how did that be directed? Were you encouraging them to
I mean, it's a delicate dance, and you as an anthropologist would know we have to respect and uphold the culture and what people are used to eating. So that's just part of the culture as a student. So there's just, you know, we're trying to make these small behavior changes where it's not as watery, or encouraging them to fry the fish because then you have the absorption of the fat cycle. Vitamins. So in gentle ways that aren't going to disrupt that. But it's actually a universal practice around the world. The use of porridge and the watery porridge. It's universal. It's, again, poverty, but it's pretty serious in terms of child malnutrition, what occurs. Because again, it fills the stomach. And people do it because they can't afford to do otherwise. WHO is actually considering discouraging porridge consumption. I know, which would be, they didn't end up doing it. For this particular project in coastal Kenya, we're just focusing on fisheries, marine fisheries. So the Fish Innovation Lab has several research projects related to aquaculture. But ours is because these fishers fish in the ocean. We're targeting the whole family. So it's the outcome is the child. That's our primary outcome is child growth. But the whole family matters, right? Even the older people in the household, even the community. So we're also targeting the beach management unit, I mentioned that, and community health workers. They're actually part of the interventions there. We've trained them. This is what how social marketing works. You don't just say, okay, do this, here's education. You have to target like multiple levels with different messages. And that's why, thank goodness, we have a year to do this, because it's not, it doesn't happen. So there was a paper that got all kinds of attention that showed that fish from different ecosystems, different habitats, had different nutritional differences. However, what the authors failed to do was say, is that meaningful from the human health point of view? And I'm not convinced yet it is. There are differences, like the small fish example. And fatty acids, I think, are more responsive, and these are my fish people can speak to, more responsive to different feeding regimens for the fish too. It's more responsive, but you know, I'm not convinced. I think freshwater marine fish, it doesn't matter. They're going to have basically the nutrients that I'm talking about that are in between. I don't think I answered that clearly, but I don't know that we have that answer fully.
Up on that, by the comment, one of the things that I really caught my attention when you were taught by the student, it was the thing on the lunch. So, Mary and I and our and Robert did research pre COVID, was it 2019? It seems like eons ago, at Lake Waikiki. And this lake is so vast. If you've ever been out in the middle of the ocean and you can't see anything, that's what it was like. And we were on a crappy little boat, we had a crappy little life vest, and almost all of the adult men and younger folks on the lake, they have no safety equipment. And the storm will blow up really fast. And what really caught my eye is this is a positive energy consequence of this outcome and situation that men and boys would have safety here that they do not have access to.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, which is a huge love of the community and to their family. Any other questions or comments from anyone? Oh, we've got
here. As an outsider, I just want to make a comment from the presentation. So, your goal is to run to the kids more than 5 years ago. So maybe not short-term solution to
Thank you for offering. That's wonderful. Yeah, no,
you're defending for that. What the heck?
I know. No, I actually in Ecuador right now I have a diet intervention that's in pregnant women. They're doing a whole diet. I've never done that before. My other research has been just eggs or fish, for example. I mean, there are ways to do that, even in our country, right? Where you have food that you can provide in the short term. And I think it's really important to get people through that. Breastfeeding, actually, if you go beyond 6 months, exclusive breastfeeding, this happens in India a lot, where you have continued breastfeeding, exclusive breastfeeding. That results in malnutrition because your child needs solid foods at 6 months. So yeah, I think it's very important to the continued breastfeeding for 2 years is very, absolutely right. Because of all the nutrients that you get in the breast milk and the bioactive factors that you get in breast milk. But they also need a complementary food. But thanks for offering that solution.
Well, it will be extra work for me.
Yeah. Do you have a question?
Yeah. See, I love, yeah, we have a project in Haiti where we're working with schools, and I think that's where you've got this huge potential because you have a market. If you have school feeding programs, right, where you the small fishers can sell to the schools, and it's like built in. And there's this is an example in India again where they had this very big dairy project that was linked to school, and they're doing it in Kenya too, to schools. I think it's actually one of the largest nutrition public programming interventions we do around the world, but not enough people are studying the nutrition effects of the kinds of foods that are being used. So I think there's lots of potential. And again, the brain development is really important.
I think that's all the time we have, so thank you all. And I'm going to show the words of Southern Hospitality and make sure that it's very much. Seafood and the grit, sorry. So thank you very much, and please give a round of applause.